All right, Matt Pat, you've made another Pokemon theory. Let's see how good your theories actually are. Whoa, hey. That's a loud one, Jesus Christ.
You are killing Pokemon. In the established
Let's go.
Our player character, at least, are the reason that at least 25 Pokemon species have gone extinct. That's not even really a theory. It is established within the canon. To be fair, it's buried way down in there.
Okay, if I guess what we've made extinct, ironically, it's not going to be Doduo. Wait, you extinct them? So it's like in the past? So it's all the Hisuians then. You're going to say it's all the Hisuians because they don't exist in the future, right?
It requires you to connect a few dots, but I have one.
I would imagine that's what it's going to be.
Confidence that Game Freak has expressly put this in here for observant, dedicated players. And perhaps strangest of all, this steamrolling of the wildlife, us bumping innocent animals permanently off the mortal coil, it's all because of a message from God, the Pokemon God, Arceus. He gives us this divine mission to exterminate the Mon. If you thought Pokemon lore was weird before... Just wait until you hear this one.
Dude, there's a lot of weird Pokemon lore. You've got Ash's... I was gonna say theories. There's a lot of weird theories out there. You got Ash is in a coma. There's a lot of weird lore. You've got your mask is a dead person that carries around their face. You've got the fact that pretty much every ghost type from Generation 6 kills kids. Drifloon kidnaps kids.
Hello, internet. Welcome to Game Theory, the only show that's nerdy enough to remind you that Ho-Oh isn't just a Pokemon. It's also the chemical formula for hydrogen peroxide. Drop that knowledge bomb next time you're in Mrs. Nagy's third period chemistry class. Ladies and gentlemen, there are three things that are certain in this world. Death, taxes, and new Pokemon games. We just had a Pokemon Presents last week. We're rapidly approaching the release of Pokemon Scarlet and Violet. Even Pokemon Go is making itself a bit of a resurgence. In short, Pokemania is in the air. So I figured it was time we took another look at the series. And what better game to talk about than the smash hit of 2022, Pokemon Legends Arceus.
It's crazy to think about that we had two almost main series games back to back like that in November and in January, and then we're gonna get another one at the end of the month. Like, they are just speed running game development right now.
Remakes have literally just been
for good or for bad.
Formula that's been reused since the mid 90s. Legends Arceus threw that formula out into the rubbish. It's the first game in the core series to give players an open world to explore. But while it certainly was a new look, it wasn't a new world. In this game, you're actually running through an ancient version of Sinnoh, the region from Gen 4's Diamond, Pearl, and Platinum. How far back in the past are we talking? Unfortunately, the game doesn't explicitly tell us, but
I think it's like 300 years in the past. I would say it's like feudal Japan. I'd probably say like between 5 and 300 years ago.
Based on the somewhat modern amenities of Jubilife Village, like binded books.
They do have a lot of amenities, that's true.
Architectural inspiration for the Galaxy Hall. The game seems to take place in the Meiji era of Japanese history, which took place from around 1868 to 1912.
I was a little bit off. Okay, I was wrong. I'll take the L on that one.
Houses and clothing in Jubilife Village seem to resemble that of the Edo era, the era prior to Meiji, more likely to be closer to that.
Oh, 1603, eh? Well, that's 400, which is smack dab in the middle of my suggestion, so...
40 years ago, Mark. So really, this thing was one part Pokemon game and one part history lesson for that fictional region. And while it's certainly fun picking up on all the similarities from two games set in the same region from two different time periods, like map locations, logo artwork, and ancestral connections between NPCs, what really tickled my theorist senses were the differences between the two regions that seem to have happened in that 140-year gap. There are some obvious ones, like the region's name being changed from Hisui to Sinnoh, and isolated camps evolving into urbanized cities, but clearly I'm not here to talk about my love of geography or urban planning. I'm here to talk about the biggest difference of them all, the Pokemon. There are a good number of Pokemon that we find in the Hisui region that are completely new, ones that don't make an appearance in the Gen 4 games.
I bet someone's gonna come along and say, oh, well, technically they may not be extinct, we just may have not seen them in the modern age yet. Still around somewhere, who knows?
Remakes or any other core installment in the series. Doing a quick comparison of the Hisui and Sinnoh dexes shows us that there's a whopping 25 Pokemon that are found somewhere in the Hisui region that are completely absent from other titles. Pokemon like the adorable Hisuian Growlithe and the hauntingly new evolution.
I want to know how we made these extinct.
But why? Where'd they go? We've been in this region before. We've seen everything there is to see here. And yet, in the 140-year history between this game and Gen 4, 25 Pokemon apparently got wiped out. Unsurprisingly, the game...
They didn't really get wiped out. Like, Hisuian Growlithe is... Growlithe's still around in other countries.
...what happened to all these Pokemon. Based on my findings, it's for a good reason. You see, they're shielding us from the truth. We killed them. We are responsible. We're the reason those 25 Pokemon variants are gone now. We made them go extinct. So come with me, loyal theorists, as we go big lore hunting. To figure out.
You know, as it's fine. Basket Legion kind of deserves
it. What exactly happened to all these new, old Pokemon? But before we set off on adventure, we have to be equipped like a Pokemon trainer. Have you ever stopped to think about how much stuff a trainer actually needs to carry around? Rare stones, candies, antidotes, whatever the heck a TM is. And that
is this
where
an
our
ad?
Newest line of Fury Wear comes
from. Ah, it's an ad. Okay.
Merch drop time. Starting with our newest and most
advanced backpack. Fury March, baby!
Backpack. This thing literally is the
look where you can get backpacks.
Heavy duty and with plenty of room for your laptop, your favorite Pokemon.
You can put your laptop in there. Let's go!
Okay, balls. Eat your heart out, Ash Ketchum, because this is
damn
just a
Matt Pat. You looking
backpack.
Fine
this
in this one?
Strings and bungee cords that allow you to quickly access all your most important.
Think about how Gabron you look on the playground.
Fashion, but it's also loaded with fashion. That's actually why I wanted to lean more into the subtle coloring and branding with this one.
Damn, you look like you're just out of Mr. Robot in this one.
Comfortably come with you to any school or professional setting. It's not gonna stand out like a sword.
Take that to school.
Obviously,
people will think that you're epic.
Or if you're looking for something smaller that can hold a couple of things in a simple grab-and-go style, check out the Techwear shoulder bag. It's compact and light, which makes it perfect if you live in a place where you have to do a lot of walking. True story. Oh
man, if you have to walk,
this
bag's for you.
Lifesaver, because it was able to hold the few items that I wanted from the store, all without weighing me down or feeling like a burden to bring along. And
if you hate weights, this bag's for you.
Here in the city, one of the things that I was always bringing along in that bag, water, which is why I always kept the new game.
And you can stay hydrated too.
This no leak, practically unbreakable Nalgene style bottle is built in with achievements written along the side to make it
achievements
clear when you hit different hydration milestones along the.
Because staying hydrated is impossible for gamers unless they can get gamer points.
Wait,
for
can
it.
Can you be one of the people to get the platinum trophy in hydration?
Thanks, MatPat. I appreciate
the
that.
The long-awaited evolution for the Pokemon Stantler. Now, in Legends Arceus, Stantlers are plentiful. You practically trip over these guys. But in Sinnoh, not so much. They can only be obtained on one specific route using the Poke Radar. And as for Wordier, they don't exist. Like, not at all. For a Stantler to become a Wordier, it needs to use the move Psy Shield Bash a total of 20 times. But Psy Shield Bash isn't a move that Stantlers can learn in games set in the future. So not...
Maybe the way to do it was just lost. Sometimes you just forget things. Sometimes information is lost to the ages. Maybe Psy Shield Bash was just bred out of Stantler, like you breed bulldogs or any other type of dog breed. Maybe they just didn't use it and then everyone forgot how to do it.
Not only has the overall number of Stantlers shrunk, but it's also lost the ability to use a move that's critical for its evolution into Wordier. That's weird, right? So inevitably I have to ask the question, why? Clearly the game designers consciously made this decision, so what are they trying to tell us? What reason would Stantlers have to forget an entire move? Well, Wordier's Pokedex entry actually gives us a hint.
The black orbs shine.
I guess I can't use my normal Pokedex voice since this game doesn't have an electronic Pokedex. Gotta go with the old-fashioned method.
The black orbs shine with an uncanny light when the Pokemon is erecting invisible barriers.
The dude, what the? Who is the voice actor for this? Goddamn.
Fur shed from its beard retains heat well and is highly useful material for winter clothing.
Useful in cold weather, huh? Sure sounds like something that the citizens of the cold history.
Goddamn, my voice.
Pretty valuable. Once people read that Pokedex entry, it's likely they're going to be tempted to try and get their hands on Wordier to obtain that precious fur, especially as they continue expanding into areas like the icy north. So it would seem like Wordier were hunted to extinction for their fur, while the remaining Stantlers did their best to avoid evolving, choosing to flee rather than fight, much like real-life deer are known to do. For the Stantlers, evolving just wasn't worth the added stat increase if it made it harder to survive. After generations and generations—
True, it's not really evolution if it makes it die more often. Evolution is supposed to work in the opposite way. When you evolve, you're supposed to become better adapted to your surroundings, not less adapted or more likely to be hunted.
For Stantlers avoiding fights with humans, and especially avoiding the use of Psy Shield Bash out of a fear of evolving, they would eventually forget how to use the move entirely in order to—
Now that actually works, because that relates to the real world. If you do something and it ends up getting you killed, then the creatures that survive and adapt and live are the creatures that don't do that thing that gets them killed.
Chances of survival. No Psy Shield Bash means no evolving.
Or doesn't get them hunted more often.
Wordier. And they aren't the only species that was basically bullied into extinction either. Take the Hisuian Quillfish, a regional variant that's been totally wiped out from Sinnoh by the time Gen 4 rolls around. Looking at its Pokedex entry though, immediately you start to see why this guy might have been on the chopping block. It tells us that
Fishers detest this troublesome Pokemon because it sprays poison from its spines, getting it everywhere. A different form of quillfish lives in other regions.
If you look at the Cobalt coastline, one of the main locations for Hisuian quillfish, we see that in the intervening 140 years, this actually becomes Gen 4's Route 223, a prime fishing location thanks to the Sunny Shore Market and a swimming location on the way to Victory Road. What?
So we just did a little bit of quillfish genocide? We just did a little bit of extinction because we didn't like the poison?
This tells us is that fishermen, fed up with the poisonous quillfish, hunted them to extinction so the coastline could be better used for commercial and recreational purposes. They eliminated
I hate capitalism.
What they saw as a problematic fish, which directly leads to what we see in Sinnoh years later. And it's not like it would be hard for them to do either, considering the Diamond and Pearl Pokedex entries call the quillfish a poor swimmer. There's also a second reason that fishermen might have
How do you live in water and be a poor swimmer?
But this one isn't as directly called out. Food. We've talked over on Food Theory about eating Pokemon, but quillfish are likely to be a delicacy in this universe. There's a type-
Oh no, is this the Pokemon version of that one creature that you can catch and if you eat its poison you die, but then they have these really high class restaurants that prepare it in such a special way? I remember that. It's from the Simpsons episode, right?
A real-world pufferfish called Fugu. It contains a super deadly neurotoxin, just like
That's what it is! That's literally what it is, pre-watched.
And it, too, is a delicacy in many parts of Japan, only being served by specially trained chefs who know how to prepare the meat without killing their customers. Hisuian quillfish would probably work in the same
way. Why would
you
ever try this?
Regardless, though, whether it was to clear a nuisance or fill the restaurants, humans were the ones that wiped these guys out from the coastlines of Hisui. Speaking of being hunted, let's look at two more examples of hunted Pokemon, Hisuian Voltorbs and Electrodes. Looking at them, it's immediately clear that these two have had some of the most dramatic changes in their design. The Kanto versions of these Pokemon are made of some sort of metal-like compound, while the Hisuian Electrodes Pokedex entry says that the body is made of a, quote, material curiously similar to apricorn wood. Now, this is an important detail because historically, apricorns were used to make Pokeballs. In Legends Arceus, apricorns are everywhere. But in Sinnoh, there's no more of these trees to be found. So, what happened? Well, by the end of Legends Arceus, because of the work that we did throughout the game, people are now looking to catch Pokemon for themselves. As a result, it's likely that they began to harvest apricorns at an alarming rate to craft their-
And they did it too much because we can't do anything sustainably, can we?
But in the rush, no one thought to do it sustainably. And suddenly, there are no more apricorn trees left in the region. So, without the wood to build Pokeballs, what do you do then? You start to hunt the animal that has a body made of a very similar wood.
Okay, I actually feel like, yeah, that makes sense. That is directly the character's fault because the character basically got everyone to start using Pokeballs. And then if it's made of the same wood, then you can make Pokeballs out of it. And you kill them all.
Voltorbs and Electrodes. Over time, to avoid going extinct, Hisuian Voltorb and Electrode may have evolved into their metal form that would prevent them from getting poached by the would-be Kurtz of the world. And this directly
Okay, I mean, that's actually a pretty decent one. I respect that.
Life. Many elephants are slaughtered specifically for their tusks, right? Well, this has historically been happening so much that elephants in heavily hunted areas
I can't believe that people killed elephants because they thought it was an aphrodisiac. They thought it would help them get bonus.
Evolved to have smaller tusks, or even no tusks at all. Since poachers
no,
are hunting
they look
them
bald without
tusks,
them.
Elephants with no tusks have an evolutionary advantage, thereby passing that trait along. Just like a metal Voltorb and Electrode would have a survival advantage.
I think we should poach the poachers.
Variants. But it wasn't just overhunting that was a problem in that 140-year period. It was also an overuse of the region's resources. Ursaluna and Cleaver are two new evolutions of Ursaring and Scyther that we see in Legends Arceus that require the use of a specific item to evolve. Ursaring needs the peat block, and Scyther needs the black auger.
Fuck the peat block, man.
Scyther are certainly
it makes me so mad when I think about the peat block. Also, I really don't like Ursaluna. The fact that it has mud just on its nose all the time, like, just wash your face, please. Just wash your face. You're so dirty. You look bad. Oh my god.
We can explain by looking at the difference between Hisui and Sinnoh. The peat block item is based on the real life material known as, well, peat. Basically, it's like a precursor to coal. It takes thousands of years to form, and it can be burned for fuel. Based on the cities that we see in Gen 4, it's clear that there was an increase in industrialization in the Sinnoh region. Industrialization means machines, and machines need fuel. And hey, look, here's a readily available material that's just laying here with no other discernible purpose. Might as well use it until it's gone. Black augurite
Well, that's just like standard evolution and industry. That's not our fault. It's not the trainer's fault that that happened. We can stop the Industrial Revolution. Gonna single-handedly stop progression from happening.
A similar fate. The name originally led me to believe that black augurite is based off the mineral augite. However, looking at the in-game sprites and description, the two don't seem to line up. Its black, glassy texture actually makes it more likely to be obsidian. Obsidian's a material that's made from the rapid cooling of lava, and it's been used for centuries.
Oh my god, wait, is that real? I thought that was just Minecraft.
A sharp material for tools. The only active volcano that we see in the Hisui region is this one off the Cobalt Coast.
Dog, why is that Gyarados so fat? What the hell? The Gyarados is bigger than a mountain. Perspective, man. What's going on?
Which, based on its shape, is what they call a cinder cone volcano. Cinder cone volcanoes don't tend to make obsidian. The only other place it could have come from is Mount Coronet, which the box art does seem to imply is a volcano, but it appears to have been
because it's hot
years.
At the top.
Therefore, it's safe to say that black augurite is going to be in limited supply. It, along with peat, are non-renewable resources. So when humanity expanded its presence in the region and wound up using up all these items, Ursaring and Scyther no longer had the ability to evolve. You know who else disappeared from the region because the natural environment changed? Arcanine, Avalug, and Decidueye,
which is so sad because the Arcanine is so sick. The Avalug sucks, though. Don't care about the Avalug.
All have Pokedex entries that specifically mention being adapted to the colder climate and snow of the Hisui region. Hisui
climate
is an
change.
Island, and islands are small. When habitats are smaller, that means that the organisms that live
it's
there.
It's getting a little bit too real
specialized.
For us now.
For example, take the famous finches studied by Charles Darwin on the Galapagos Islands. What he saw was that each finch evolved a completely unique beak shape based on the island that it lived on. This comes with the benefit of making you really well suited to your environment, but the downside is that if anything changes, then your specialized traits won't do you any good. And that's exactly what happened with these Hisui Pokemon. As humans expanded their reach into the area, as they industrialized, the climate of Hisui became warmer. This uptick in human development, the deforestation that came with it, all of it led to a shift in biodiversity of the region, meaning some of these Pokemon were no longer able to make the cut. Now,
this happens all the time. Humans move into an area, ruin a thing, and then move on to the next thing to then ruin. We are the infestation that is killing the planet. If aliens came along and they were like, oh, these humans, they kind of suck and just vaporized all of us and left everything else, I wouldn't blame them.
These are only a few examples of what happened to these region-specific Pokemon, but you can see the pattern, right? All these Pokemon are gone thanks to one specific factor. Humans. Humans plundering resources, humans overhunting, humans overexpanding. In the 140 years between Legends Arceus and Gen 4, humans have completely morphed the landscape of the Sinnoh region, and the game designers have clearly thought through that history. They didn't just insert designs and evolutions into this world arbitrarily. The whole thing was thoughtful, intentional. It was told to us through hints in the Pokedex. In the end, we get ourselves a game that has a really strong environmental message if we just bother to piece together the breadcrumbs that they left behind for us. Except there's still...
Does anyone else think climate change is bad?
A piece that I haven't connected. During the game, we learn that the people of Hisui are afraid of Pokemon. Some even worship them. The little village that you start off in isn't able to expand more because they're afraid to face the monsters that lurk out in the wilderness. But someone changes that, and in so doing, signs.
Oh, I see how it all comes together. The trainer comes along and changes everything, so the humans are like, oh boy, let's go and do colonization and expansion and overexpansion and industrialization and progression. And make a bunch of things and do longer hunting. Oh, so it's all our fault. Well, technically, no. It's Arceus's fault because Arceus was the one that sent us back in time to do that in the first place. He's God. He supposedly knows what is going on. I assume that God of the Pokemon world is omnipotent, so he knows what's going to happen. He sent us back anyway. He knew it was going to happen. So really, if we should be blaming anyone in this situation, it's God. It's God's fault.
Death warrant. That person is you. At the start of the game, your character is called back in time by the God Pokemon Arceus. When you land, you're immediately tasked with catching Pokemon, something that other people are afraid to do. But you know better. You come from the future, so you persist. You teach people that Pokemon can be your friends, that they can be used to help with chores. You can even collect them and use them for competitive sports.
You teach humans that Pokemon can be your friends. In response, they destroy their habitats and murder them for resources.
Without this fear of Pokemon, the human race is now able to expand throughout Hisui. Thanks to you, they're no longer afraid to hunt Wurdier for their fur, to exterminate
pests. Yeah, good job, mate. Well done. You must be very proud.
Resources. If you had decided to not be a hero, to not save the day, the region would have remained too inhospitable.
If you were just a normal human and had a mental breakdown from being sent back in time like a normal person would, then everything would have been fine. But no, you had to be the protagonist and have destiny awaiting for you and go out and actually do things. And then you went and ruined everything.
For civilization to truly grow, and humans would have chosen to avoid it entirely. Kind of makes you wonder if that god Pokemon who sent us back in time was so benevolent after all. But
right?
Hey, here's your last reminder to
I knew it. So really, the main villain of Legends Arceus is actually Arceus when you think about it, because he caused the absolute environmental destruction of basically the entire region. If you think God is bad, then let me know in the comments section below. I stream on my YouTube channel every day. Bye.